Well, there's a couple of reasons for that. Firstly, I think with all its good intentions, the Royal Commission's recommendations weren't well calibrated to deal with the problem. I think partly that's because they just didn't have the information we now have. But on top of that, we had other problems that wreaked havoc through Aboriginal communities. The first one was the heroin epidemic, which through the 1990s had terrible effects on rates of juvenile Aboriginal involvement in property crime. It started in Redfern, but it quickly spread right across the country, and that increased Aboriginal imprisonment rates. And then from 2000 onwards, the courts started getting much tougher on violence, and violence has been historically a big problem in many Aboriginal communities. So you had a second wave of increased imprisonment as a result of that.
I guess one of the popular views out there is that the Indigenous overrepresentation in our jails is due to some sort of racial bias within the criminal justice system, but you have quite a different view, don't you?
I do. I mean, there's no question that Aboriginal people have been victims of racial bias in the justice system historically. I don't question that at all. You've only got to look at the statistics, for example, on arrests, assault police, resist arrest, offensive behaviour. They certainly show an overrepresentation of Aboriginal people. If you look at the prison population now, though, and have a look at what Indigenous Australians are in prison for, the overwhelming reason is violence or conviction for a violent offence. And the overwhelming proportion of victims of this violence are other Aboriginal people, especially Aboriginal women and children. The second most common reason is burglary, for example, and robbery, those sorts of offences, and breaching orders. So they're not in custody any longer for trivial offences. They might have been once, but that's not the problem now. So it's for that reason and because of other research showing that bias is no longer a major problem in the court system that I think that's really not the issue.
So what then, in your opinion, are some of the solutions to try and address this problem of Aboriginal people being overrepresented in the criminal justice system?
Well, I think we need two strategies, one's for the short term and one's for the long term. In the short run, we've really got to do much more to stop Aboriginal offenders when they're released from jail going back to jail. And what that means is focusing on employment for Aboriginal people when they come out of jail, focusing on drug treatment for those who've got significant drug or alcohol problems, ensuring access to adequate housing, doing the sorts of things that are necessary to stop someone tripping up and going straight back into custody. I think that's absolutely crucial in the short run. And we've done works which shows that that would produce a big effect pretty quickly. In the longer run, though, I think the principal problem we need to tackle is drug and alcohol abuse. I think this not only has direct effects on Indigenous involvement in crime, but it also has a destructive effect on Indigenous families, makes it hard for young kids to grow up healthy, do well at school, and if you don't do well at school and you don't grow up healthy, it's very hard to get a job even if jobs are on offer. So I think that's a very important part of it as well.